company because of the dual tax treaty that exists today. A Singapore company, and this used to be similar to Mauritius, and one can get into the pros and cons. For Singapore company, if it owns an Indian company, capital gains for selling an Indian entity, capital gains is zero. So today, when you think of structure, it's not sufficient for you to optimize for today's cash flow, but tomorrow's strategic options that you may need to consider. Any questions here? Happy to take questions. Make it as interactive as possible. Wake up before lunch, perhaps. Yeah? That's it. So we are in. So your question is: slideshow that CSP was the buyer shareholder. Was CSP had the liquidity, or did you borrow? Is that what your question is? So we are an investment holding company, and we are effectively at work as a private equity fund. So we have our own investors, and we invest our own principal capital. Okay. Show confidence in the acquisition idea to the other buyers, or was profit the motive, or both? So why are the other shareholders joining us? Is that what your question is? Yeah, so ultimately, I mean, you know, the same reason that Bala said today, yields are going towards zero. Everybody's looking for yield, right? If you look at who my other investors were, they're pension funds. In fact, Hermes is actually one of our core investors. So as a private equity fund, with due respect, no one buys a company by writing a check from their checking account. It's always somebody's money. If you're a listed company, you're buying a company from shareholders' funds, who happens to be your shareholders. So for us, we have a group of investors that the core investor group for us is primarily pension funds, large endowments, large insurance companies. So when it comes to the debt and the tax structuring issues, a few thumb rules, if you will, from our experience of having done this for a living. And I think, again, Bala used the word cash is king. My first rule of thumb is just follow the cash. Where is it created? Where does it go? Who takes a cut out of it, whether it's in taxes, regulatory fees, whatever it is, right? One can, you know, make it as complex as you want, with all the regulations, and all of you are chartered accountants, and I'm sure you're well-versed in all the regulations than I am, but I have a very simple thumb rule. Just follow the cash. Second thumb rule that we utilize, and we like it, is, you know, all of you have backgrounds in financial management, and, you know, if you're an Indian company, it notionally looks like, wow, dollar debt is really cheap. So if I'm an Indian company and I could go out there and borrow at 4%, notionally, that looks good. But do not forget that your operating earnings for a company is where you get your tax shields. So we like to use debt where we get the operating earnings. In Venax, we had a Singapore holding company, but we didn't take the debt, senior debt at Singapore holding company. We took the senior debt, created an SPV in Canada, took the debt in Canada because Canada produces and the US produces the highest amount of operating earnings. Then, by the way, we merged the two companies. I'm able to use the entire interest as a tax deduction against the operating earnings. So for you, you have to think about where is the cash being generated? How do I put debt against that? And not necessarily in a jurisdiction where notionally or nominally the interest rate is cheaper, right? Double tax agreements are important. And I guarantee you there is no one expert that knows it all. Right? So have access to experts. If it's US, Canada, if it's you know, Bahrain and Singapore, if it's Dubai and India, there will be specialists. You'll need to get them all. For anybody who deals with banks, and I'm sure probably 95% of you do, or representatives of banks, believe me, I'm an American citizen, and I'm extremely worried about FATCA. Anybody that touches anything to do with bank debt, especially going forward, I believe there were some grandfather clauses. FATCA is just painful. It is painful today. It's going to be even more painful tomorrow. And believe me, it will have a real impact on the on your cost of money. And last but not the least, you know, in today's world, where by definition you are having to deal with multi-currency risk, again, notionally, if you borrow in euros or you borrow in dollars or you borrow something else, you know, one can go and borrow Japanese yen at, I don't know, 150 basis points perhaps. But we don't like to do that because we like to always use natural hedges. And while every investment bank will try to sell you some esoteric hedge, believe me, you can never completely risk currency risks. So again, rule of thumb, put debt where your operating incomes come from. Take debt where your currency is your revenue driven. Last but not the least, get the cross-border experts or at least a group of experts available. Please. Thank you so much. So I'll take the question now, and I'll come back to you with the answer a little later. Your question is post an acquisition. Sometimes it fails to meet its objectives, right? How do you safeguard it? Let me hold the question, come back to you on my section, because we'll address it, right? It's not moving. The rules are so important that they don't want to go away from the screen. We really need you to memorize it, right? Is that the logical explanation? Yeah, exactly. We need to restructure this. That's okay. Why don't you restart it? Do the three-finger salute to Windows. Sure. I'll keep going, and you can keep the questions coming. I'll take them all, no worries. Vivek, why don't you restart it? We'll continue. My next section, right after the debt and the tax restructuring aspects, were primarily around... It always helps to keep a backup when you're presenting. You know, to address your question, what I'm going to do is to really go back and kind of go back to 101, if you will, and say, how is really value created, right? Your question is, acquisitions are done, things don't work out. What happens? So before I go into that, let me kind of go back and show you a simplified model. And it would be helpful to bring up the slide here. You know, what is really creating a value, or how do investors get money? And fundamentally, it's really driven by what I would say four things, right? Operating cash flow, whatever your business is, if it's a bank, it's a spread business, if it's selling mobile phones, it's what are you buying it at, what are you selling it at, if you're making, you know, branded ceramics, I guess, what is your price versus cost? So I'm going to define that as part of what I call free operating cash flow. You know, we're not going there, we're primarily financial managers here. Now, do not forget that after you go get an operating cash flow, there are three important things that's really driving the free cash. It's your capital expense, it's your change of working capital, and it's your taxes paid. By the way, all of you here, we actually effectively are responsible for leadership on these three things. So fundamentally, when we do buyouts, what we assume, and now let me kind of jump ahead a little bit and share with you one of my learnings, all forecasts are wrong. I assume that. No forecast in the world. If there is one human being who can tell me they can forecast correctly, you know what? We should all retire. Right? So I guarantee you all forecasts will be wrong. Question is, what is the degree of error? What is the direction of error? Right? So you can keep going ad nauseum trying to get a perfect forecast of what the world is going to look like tomorrow. I guarantee you, I don't know. What I do know, and that's what I focus on, is what is the degree of error that can happen? What is the direction of error? And so therefore, to answer your question, which is how do you make sure that your thesis of what's going to happen tomorrow is ensured, is we focus on ensuring what is the degree of error we can control, what is the degree of error we cannot control. Do I know what the hedge is going to be, dollar exchange versus Indian rupee exchange tomorrow? I have no clue. Therefore, you know what? If I'm producing revenues in rupees, I will not do dollar debt. Can I predict what my margins are going to be in relative to, let's say, in Minack's case, one of the largest customers is General Motors, and Minack has done business for General Motors for the last 30 years, and therefore I can project that the margins of the General Motors business is going to be within X percent of what it has actually done for the last 20 years? This is something I can control. So all variables in the forecasting model is what we pull to be, you know, intrinsic. Line managers can control. Extrinsic, we cannot control. But we start from the assumption all forecasts are wrong. Right? And so therefore, if you go back to the slide before, please, I just want to kind of reiterate the creation of value is really coming from your, and we are not going to do a quiz to go through the lines. I think the only highlight I'm going to say is free operating cash flow, CapEx, working capital change, tax. So when you reduce working capital, when you reduce accounts receivable, days outstanding, it is creating real value, right? We all know that. But you don't see it unless it's kind of reflected. Oh, by the way, and I know all of some of you in GCC countries have the privilege of not worrying about taxes, but you know what? We come with two things that are given. One, you will die, and two, you will pay taxes all your life, right? So in that environment, taxes are important because it sucks out real cash. The reason we did Minack, we restructured the entire company, is because I can share with you that Canada to UK, there's a 5% withholding tax. From UK to Singapore, there's 0% withholding tax. So for me to make profits in Canada and move it to the Singapore holding company, it cost me 5%. Right? How do I know that? I just follow the cash. Right? If my cash goes from you to me to you, you to him, please tell me how much you will take, Mr. Canada, Canadian government or Mr. UK government. So for us, taxes, capital expense, changing working capital is important. And in that context, going to the next level, please recognize that in this scenario that I've presented to you, and when you get a chance to look at it, what I am sharing with you is in a low growth environment, and let's say the operating cash flow is growing at 5%, with the proper leverage, with the proper below operating line management, one can deliver a 19-20% return. Your investors care about what is the return. So in this environment example I've given you, I invest stock with $400 million as my investment. I get, I think, 950-odd million. What's the number there? 950. And, oh, by the way, this is an operating business that's growing at 5%. So capital structure matters. Taxes matter. Managing working capital matters. Managing your capital expense. Now, every business, all of you are financial leaders. I'm sure you remember the late discussions, long conversations you have had with line managers saying, I need CapEx of X, and you as the CFO is saying, well, let's talk about it. In that scenario, if just the it's not only the quantum of CapEx, but the timing of CapEx, right? And so in that context, capital structure, proper leverage, proper below the operating line is able to deliver a 20% return to investors for a 5% operating business. Simple example. And moving ahead, what are the learnings? Some of this, again, might sound like, you know, motherhood and apple pie for you guys. But at least a few things that I will share with you, and then I'll go to the questions. I've kind of shared a few do's and don'ts here. And especially coming from primarily all of you are chartered accountants, and historical financials and historical profit and loss are important. But from my point of view, we review the financials, but you know what? We are not in the business of buying history. We buy, and you should buy, future cash flows. right? So the historicals are important as much as they can give you a guidance to what that future cash flow is going to be, right? All of you here are specialists in due diligence. You know, we love doing due diligence on financials. We love lawyers doing due diligence on all the legal aspects. But you know what? Make sure you spend some money and go do due diligence on the people who are going to run the business. So we will actually hire investigative agencies. We will go and speak to friends, families, and foes of the people who are going to run the business. Because ultimately, it's no, you know, Martian who's going to come and deliver the free operating cash flow. It's the human beings. We need to know them. You need to know them. So before doing any acquisition, you should have absolute clarity. Who is going to deliver on these numbers? Who are these people? Where do they come from? What their incentives are? What their disincentives are? What are the issues they have dealt with in the past? And every dollar I have spent on due diligence on this has been the best dollars we have spent. Last but not the least, get a right set of lawyers. I intentionally wanted to make the statement because I guess some of you chartered accountants are also lawyers. I didn't need to make the statement, get the right chartered accountants, because that's understood, right? For us, in the Minax transaction, we had 11 law firms. Yes, believe it or not. We had every jurisdiction and we had law firms from every one of them. And to make them work together is a nightmare, but c'est la vie. On the don'ts, and it's kind of reiterating the point that I made before, all forecasts are wrong. Don't believe any forecast. Question is, what is your degree of error? What is your direction of error? How much error can you account for? Right? So if oil prices have dropped by 30%, are you going to hit your bank covenants? Guys like us worry about that. We will actually run scenarios beforehand to make sure we can. Right? If I can meet my bank covenants and I can keep paying my debt, I can probably survive through a downturn. On the upside, clearly you need to worry about, for example, I can tell you that in the Minax senior debt, we actually put in a clause that says, you know, if my EBITDA goes up, I have the ability to draw down additional senior debt to pay down my more expensive mezzanine debt. It's automatic, right? No refinancing cost, no nothing. So I have created scenarios for worrying about downturn and taking advantage of the upturn. Last but not the least, don't take any assurances of past things being all closed. They will come back to haunt you. If anybody says, you know what, no litigation, all things clear, all taxes paid, if somebody says that to you and you are the buyer and somebody's selling, make sure you say, okay, great. Why don't you indemnify me? Right? So we don't, you know, in God we trust, the rest we verify. So we come from a world where we say, you know what? We understand all things might be closed, but either you indemnify me and you better have substance to indemnify me, or I'll buy insurance. It's built into the price. And you can go out there from today's in today's world for acquisitions where you can buy insurance, and there's a price. So you know, a few things, again, might seem like relative common sense, but these are things that I would point out today, and obviously every acquisition is unique. That's pretty much a quick summary of what I was presenting. I'm going to take a few of the questions that I have come my way and come back to address your question. How do you make sure that, show me. Anshul was going to make sure he was going to give me some questions. To answer your question, how do you make sure? We can't predict what the world is going to be today. I don't think any of you here could predict that the oil price is going to go to where it has gone in the spate of time, right? So what I'm very clear about is I hope I understand financials. But you know what? I'm not a sector expert of how to run a business process outsourcing company. I've never run it. So what I do for sure is for every transaction we do, we make sure we have an operating partner. So in this particular case, in MetaAccess case, we brought in the ex-CEO of Aegis, which was a company he built from $50 million to $1 billion in 8 years. Made him the executive chairman of MetaX, made him to be a minority investor by investing $1 million of equity from his own money. Alignment of interest. I can't predict what the world is going to be. All I can do is to align interest. By the way, things might go wrong, but again, go back to measuring what is the degree of error you can support. That's what we do. Some other people might have better ideas. Clearly, you know, that's what you do. So if tax is one of the primary points to consider, I think, Anshul, this is your question. No, somebody else's. What would you consider to be a relatively tax-free regime like the GCC? Correct? So if you're living in a relatively tax-free GCC jurisdiction, how does that impact from a tax consideration point of view? Who wrote this question? Is that pretty much? You know what? I would actually suggest to you there's an arbitrage here. Right? If you take any business which is in a high tax jurisdiction, them, restructure them, utilize your tax advantage that the GCC offers, that's a benefit. Right? It also is a benefit perhaps for you to relook at what are the other jurisdictions that the GCC countries have dual taxation treaties with. Right? Oh, by the way, that will give you a natural opportunity to say, let me go look at businesses in those jurisdictions where I can take advantage of the tax. Somebody asked me a question, how do you rate the Airtel acquisition of African telecom business? Issues in managing the business after acquisition. May I? Yeah. So with due respect, sir, it's not my business to comment on what other people's acquire. Ask me questions of mine, I can tell you my answers. Generically speaking, I think, you know, I am a telecom investor. I've invested in telecom all over the world. Again, line business, you know, the issues are unique. Markets are unique in some sense, but clearly there are global trends that are affecting, right? So, you know, what Airtel has done, and in this case, I was one of the first investors in Airtel's telecom tower businesses in my previous investment avatar. So I can share with you that Airtel has done an amazing job in changing the fundamental aspect of a telecom business. Before, it used to be a capex-driven business. You went and built a network, then you sold services. Airtel turned around and what they did was they told their vendors, Mr. Ericsson, Mr. Lucent, you do the capex, I will pay you on an opex basis. That's the model they have tried to take it to Africa. Let's see. I think this is a similar question. Post M&A, sometimes it fails to meet its objectives. What safeguards can be taken? Is that Mr. Mirza? Same. So I think we addressed that. In an uncertain world, how do you time your exit? Good question. As you saw, my structure from today has already contemplated when I'm going to exit. Just like I told you forecasts, it will always be wrong. I guarantee you, whatever time of exit I say will happen, I'll be wrong. Right? Could we predict that the equity markets are going to be where it is today? I don't think so. If you could, I would have loved to be an investor with you. Right? So what we focus on is running the operating business. Right? So how do I focus on how much cash is being generated by this business, or how much cash do we need to invest in this business? Right? Make sure that we are able to run a sustainable business over a business cycle of 5 to 10 years. If you do that, your exit opportunities will come. Right? So I can tell you in MetaX, we obviously have an investment thesis which says, if then this happens. Now, it's my job on behalf of my investors who have invested with me, and ultimately I'm a fiduciary, right? a lot of you are fiduciaries. You are making decisions based on organizational responsibility that's been given to you. For us, it's my job to deliver a return. So if Mumtalakat wants to come and buy Minax from me today, and they offer me a price that delivers a certain return to my investors, it's my job to look at it, right? By the way, if somebody does not give me an exit opportunity over the next 2, 3, 4 years, the business continues. And that's perfectly fine. So again, coming back to what you are saying is, you know, the reality is for us, we focus on the core business, we focus on the core cash flows, entry, exit, buying, selling. These are what I would call to be extrinsic events. I think we have taken some of your questions to kind of recollect in today's session. I want to wrap up. Sorry, I think I'm going ahead. We presented to you a summary of two cross-border acquisitions, multi-jurisdiction, complex, debt, mezzanine debt, equity. We presented to you some thumb rules to think about when you're thinking about taking debt, covenants, cross-jurisdiction, tax issues. We presented to you, at least from our point of view, what creates value. For all of you as financial managers, when you are considering acquisition as an inorganic growth path, you should look at how do you manage these. And last but not the least, a few learnings from the scars that I have, and I'm sure I'll be getting more scars later on. A few things that have worked for us, you know, nothing religious about it. They work for me, may work for you. It's up to you to decide. Thank you. Question, I think. Can you hear me? Okay. I think the question is, you do not want to dispose your asset when the market is in its peak. At the same time, when I wish to dispose, the market is not in my favor. How to approach to meet the duality of this situation? Is that, did I make sure I collected that? So the market is already in the peak for some reason. For whatever reason, you don't want to sell now. I don't know what the uncertainty is going to be, right? And if I sell tomorrow, what do I do? Well, what you can do is you can obviously hedge your bets. There's a price to it. Today you can go out there and let's say, you know, your division or a company XYZ, you can talk to guys like me who can structure an option agreement. I'll be happy to back your backstop for a price. Right? You can go to an investment bank and say, you know what, my treasury stock has run up all of this, but I don't know where the world is going to be tomorrow. You can negotiate a put option. That's available. I can tell you that in the past, as an investor, when I have invested in companies that's been sold, so I was a relatively large shareholder, I mean, obviously in very, very much, you know, relative terms, shall we say, quite a few decimal places removed from Mark Zuckerberg. This was as a result of an investment we had made into a company that was bought by Facebook. So we were, in some sense, shareholders when Facebook was going public. None of us could predict what the world was going to be. Before Facebook went public, we actually, and in my previous hat, I was Columbia Capital, we actually negotiated a put option before the market went public. And you can do that. There are financial agents, investment banks will do it for you. Does that answer your question somewhat? Yeah? Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Mr. Sanjay, for the detailed insight on mergers and acquisitions to our members. I would now request our past chairman, C. Krishnamurthy, to hand over a memento to Mr. Sanjay as a token of our gratitude. Yes. Sanjay, the raffle draw, sorry. I request Sanjay to draw a card for our lucky winner. Mr. Gopi Subhash from EK Kanu. He's the lucky winner of Cartier perfume. Thank you, Sanjay. We'll now play a small video clip to honor our sponsors, which will be followed by our chairman, Meenakshi, handing over mementos to the sponsors. Mahesh, can we have the video, please?
Dr. Hassan A. Fakru, Minister of Industry and Commerce, Kingdom of Bahrain. Bahrain Chapter of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India presents International Conference. Together towards tomorrow. CAS our strategic partner, November 28th to 29th, 2014. Our title sponsors: Mashraq Bank, BDO Jawad Habbi, Mercedes-Benz. Event sponsors: Grant Thornton. Day sponsors: Fahad Ali Rasa Engineering Consultants, KPMG, EK Kanu, PricewaterhouseCoopers. Supporting sponsors: Nimai Consultants, Tanjay Real Estate, Key Point, Expat Property, Al Namal Group, Bahrain Commercial Facilities Company, Battleco, Devji, ICAEW, Asia Jewelers, Ahli United Bank, Al Manarate, American Express, Bahrain National Insurance. Other sponsors: Gulf Hotel, State Bank of India, Arabian Reinsurance Group, Travco, KLM, UAE Exchange,
NAS, Sorox,
Jawab, Ashwar Consulting, Armor Insurance, Bahrain Financing Company, Charles Russell Speeches, Patrick York Insurance, Takaful International, Sayani Motors, Kim's Bahrain Medical Center.
We'd also like to thank our sponsors, Auto Brand, Al Salam Bank, and Bahrain Kuwait Insurance Company for their support to our chapter. I'd now request our chairman, CA Meenakshi Sundaram, to come on stage to honor our sponsors with mementos. From Key Point, I'd request Mr. Sethu Raman to be on stage to receive a memento. From Al Namal Group, I request Mr. Radhesh to be on stage to receive the memento. I request Mr. Vishal Purohit from BCFC to be on stage to receive the memento. Mr. Vishal Purohit. From Devji Jewelers, I request Mr. Jay to be on stage to receive the memento. From Asia Jewelers, I request C.A. Clifford to be on stage to receive the memento. The applause should go on. Thank you, C.A. Meenakshi, for doing the honors. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll now break for lunch. It's 12:20. So we meet back at 1:20 for another exciting raffle draw, followed by our other speakers for the day. Please help yourself with the lunch. And there is prayer room also for those people who want to do prayers. See you at exactly at 1:20. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.